The Wild Wild West was famous for its gadgets, so let's have a look at some. In the show I called What's in Jim's Boot Today, we're going to look at whole different categories, from inventory through various things, including the train, and whatever else I can think of. So we'll look at Jim and Artie's basic inventory, or what I claim it is. Jim, we know, it's the knife and the derringer and his pistol and his lockpick and so on, as we see there.
It's a wonder he didn't clank when he walked.
Artie had a coat of many things with all sorts of stuff in it, as we see. A little of this, a little of that. I'll take that one. Yes, I have a pry bar right here. The most iconic thing about Jim is the derringer. It's everywhere. The sleeve mechanism shows up all the time, whenever it's necessary, and is just operated by flexing muscles.
Well, at least we're certain of two things. Moore's Emporium was a clearinghouse for that counterfeit ring. And Bronzini was their passer. He just got a little greedy, that's all.
Mr. Bronzini?
That side hammer derringer is accurate.
You've outdone yourself this time, Dr. Lovelace.
I thank you, Mr. West.
This one, the derringer's in his left hand. It's the only time I can remember it being there. The derringer also could throw all kinds of things, mostly pitons with wires and strings attached. Here, Jim will use the two rounds to pull the heavy box off of it. As we will often see, the ropes and the strings and the wires that he used have amazing strength. These pitons get a lot of use.
Mm-hmm.
here he's in a trap room and he's going to use the piton and the wire to trigger traps safely. Another thing he used the wire for was to go up and down, in and out of buildings, and just the wire he just tossed up there, and down he goes. But more often he'd use a mechanical device, which had amazing strength, to lift him up or down. This is modern jazz, Wild Wild West, apparently. So here's that gizmo. Just apparently some sort of wind-up thing. Here he uses it to spy on different levels of the same house. And up. And up again to get an entry point. In this one, he uses the same device to go down safely from a great height. A great height. Sometimes you use a pulley instead of a mechanical device. In this case, to slide across the street. Artie will provide a diversion, and Jim will come slamming through the window with great elan. And they get away with that guy. Now this time he's going to use the pulley to knock a guy off his horse and steal the horse. Mm-hmm. This time the wire, piton, and pulley, which is in Jim's sleeve this time, will be used to cross over a vat of acid. Another one of those, that was lucky, situations. And that rope from Artie is obviously to pull him back the other way on his way out. This one's a great stunt of a fairly absurd trial for the damsel in distress. And of course, Jim had the throwing knife. The other iconic thing about Jim is the stuff in his boot heels. He had all kinds of stuff. For example, he had a derringer once, and bullets in his belt buckle. And he had a knife, which he used to cut various things. This is probably the best stunt cutting, just because it looks really hard.
Artie, I think it's time to kick up our heels and live a little.
This one is some kind of plastique. They used, as we'll see, a lot of plastic explosive-like things, which are much handier than sticks of dynamite. There's that jazz music again.
Thank you.
This one's interesting. There's an explosive somehow in his heel that goes straight down, doesn't blow his foot off, to get him out of this trap. Here's another unspecified but fortunate explosive with a convenient wind-up toy delivery system. Now he's got a small plastique to blow open his cuff. Sure looks dangerous. So this is a binary explosive. We'll run across another one of these shortly.
Hold it.
What is it?
An explosive. Hold this. Don't put them together until I tell.
A binary explosive only goes off if it's put together. Some kind of knockout gas. Here's one of the weirdest ones, a blowtorch. Which burns through the lot. Now, there were lots of exploding devices and smoking devices, so we'll look at them.
Hey, Jim.
Hmm?
Listen, where you're going without wine, women, and song, you might want to smoke. A little tobacco I blended for you special.
Thanks.
Am I allowed a last request?
Perhaps, if it's reasonable and quick.
A smoke, perhaps?
Very well. At least your hands are steady.
Match?
Here's a plastic that goes off pretty much without a detonator. Here's another one.
Your grandfather will forgive me.
The old exploding cue ball trick. Thank you. Lots and lots of plastique-like things.
A gunman once got away from me on my own horse. I decided it was never going to happen again. Watch. This is the safe, and this unlocks it. The man spots my horse and runs to it. All he has to do is put his foot on the stirrup.
And the horse is uninjured. This one goes off when it gets shot.
Well, it's unfortunate that you had to come sniffing around.
Now this one is a little bitty hand grenade. Now you might recognize that little hand grenade. It was in the hands of a villain.
You have a fine, shiny gun, and you certainly know how to use it. I, in turn, have a fine, shiny bomb, and I assure you I know how to use it. You have exactly 60 seconds, Loki.
Already had some interesting wind-up bombs. This one has a timer and a detonator.
You got 12 minutes before this thing goes off. On the gunpowder. Cigar? They're from Havana.
One of my favorite episodes with one of my favorite weapons.
Oh, you have money. After we kill you, we take the money. What's this?
It's a bomb.
A bomb?
This is explosives underneath a pail, which catapults Jim up into the air.
You know, this could make a pretty entertaining game.
Of course, you use a ball instead of a rock.
Bucket ball.
You'll never catch on.
I talked to a friend of mine who was a Green Beret in Vietnam, and he told me that this was something of a recreation. Of sticking a little bit of C4 underneath a pail, some guy standing on it, and seeing how high he could go by being blasted up with the bucket. So this is a real thing. A dangerous thing, but a real thing.
Gunpowder.
Without resorting
I hear some kind of knockout gas. A vest button bomb. Another smoke bomb.
Look, just get my hand in and take this out of the waistband.
Un momento.
Sorry, amigo.
You heard the man, Artie. He said drop it.
Guess I better.
In addition to bombs and smokers, they had flares on occasion. For distractions or signaling.
Here's to bigger and much, much better explosions.
And here is the flare of all flares distraction. Here we see Ross Martin channeling Jerry Lewis. They also had some kind of thing that looks a lot like detonation cord or det cord, which is used these days to cut down trees on occasion or cut through this and that. It burns very hot and very fast.
I will. Don't dwell on them.
No, Artie, I won't.
Doesn't this music sound like Star Trek music? I love how Artie takes the last one of these as a, this might come in handy. In addition to det cord, they seem to have some kind of det powder, which as we'll see will catch fire on its own and burn through the floor that Jim is standing on. Here's a grenade that gets fired by the pistol. Here's the other binary explosive. This is a diversion to make people think that Jim has no will of his own.
Ladies and gentlemen, you will observe the patient despite intense pain. Now please step back. Professor.
There's a pane of glass between the two of them.
Stop it! Stop it! What are you doing? No, stop it! Stop it!
A good spy needs to be able to open locks. Jim has his famous lockpick in the lapel, which comes in awfully handy all kinds of ways. They also had mechanical lock openers, which are kind of reminiscent of You Only Live Twice, the Bond movie. This is some kind of mechanical drill lockpicking thing, which... Here's Artie with another mechanical lockpick. They also had some kind of pyrotechnic lock openers, which are a little obscure in how they operate. These are my favorites. These just...
That shouldn't work.
Ready, let's create a little diversion. Release the inmates.
Good idea.
Just toss and boom. Artie was forever making new and cool things. So let's have a look at what Artie is working on. Right now he's doing chemistry work with a stereo microscope.
Jim, I think I found some very interesting developments on those shell fragments. You're not Jim.
I hear he's working on one of the explosives.
Watch the reaction that this has. To heat.
Stand back, James, my boy. I don't want anyone hurt in the process.
Hey, Artie.
Pretty good, huh?
Here's testing an explosive. Turns out a really good explosive.
Ready or not.
What are you trying to do?
I can ask you.
right in the middle of testing my new artificial lung.
And it's brilliant. If I do say so myself, Jim, you see, you put this molded piece on over your nose.
Oh, be careful, Mr. President. The glue hasn't completely dried on it.
Mm. What is it? Is it some sort of a model?
An idea of mine, yes, sir. I call it...
This gizmo turns up more or less as is in the episode Juggernaut as a sort of giant armored car.
That on top is a gun turret. I think with enough of those, we can eventually eliminate the need for cavalry completely.
You know, Mr. Gordon, it's men like you who will eventually take all the fun out of war.
I guess it goes the other way.
Look at what he's designing there. Looks like an assault rifle to me. The guys used various chemical items in their work. This one is an adhesive that will last for a certain amount of time and allow Jim to save his life and not fall into the vat of whatever that is. This is another adhesive that Jim will use to hide that object from the bad guys. This one will allow them to fake the bad guy into thinking that they've been killed. Instead of exploding, in this episode, Jim's vest buttons are acidic somehow.
I hope it works.
This is a bunch of interesting stuff. There's the cane flare. The cane gun. And this one. This one is a cane radio. Now, Marconi will not perfect the radio for another 20 years based on when this is set. Nevertheless, Jim will assemble a radio telegraph. That's the antenna he's got hanging out there to communicate with Artie.
Circumstances, alarm, Prince, but he is not to come.
come to...
Now here we have climbing claws to go up the cinder block side of this trap. Instead of claws this time, we have suction cups. Here's one of my favorites. To lull the bad guys who are watching the train into thinking that Jim and Artie are still there, they use these silhouette cutouts on this model train to give that impression.
What now, Major?
Nothing. As long as they're in there, everything is fine.
Hi, Coach, gentlemen.
Jim also has a Aston DB5 kind of super vehicle, as we shall see, to get rid of bad guys. Artie has a book gun. And somehow or other, Artie can do the Indian rope trick.
Extend yourself to meet them! Sila! I, Viribus. I, Optimus. I, Polygus. I, Artemus. Help him!
Here's some kind of torsion bar thing to get Jim out of another underwater coffin trap. See water leaking in there. This is interesting. This is very steampunk. This is a wind-up device for catching things and bringing them back to you. This is the only time I've ever seen this in a Western. It's a rifle with a folding stock.
Straight out.
I'm innocent.
Sure looks like a 1903 Springfield to me.
All right. His name is...
Here's Here's a tracking device which works by the simple expedient of using phosphorescent powder that she trails behind her. Here's a wind-up rattlesnake rattle.
Now, Mr. West, tell us about lesson number three.
Lesson number three.
And the best of all,
Rosebud.
Rosebud? It's a box of matches.
Of course. Is it? Or is it supposed to look like a box of matches?
The technical device that isn't.
Possibly. Or maybe this innocent little box contains.
What?
X-51.
Oh, ripping, Mr. West, ripping. One of those ultra weapons your chaps are always so keen on developing, huh?
That's right, Mr. Singh. X-51. At the slightest jar, it's detonated. Capable of destruction. Disintegration.
I still think you're bluffing.
You're still, brother. What do you intend doing, Mr. West?
I have an insane urge to end this whole dreary charade by throwing Rosebud.
Don't be ridiculous, Mr. West.
That would be silly, wouldn't it?
Very silly, sir.
Oh, yes.
Yes, sir.
Very silly. They are matches.
By George, you're right.
Special mention to a couple, three things. First is bulletproof vests. Very handy. As long as people shoot you in the vest.
She didn't have one of her own. Thank you.
Who itself on a night like this for? Any ideas, please?
Here's one for Artie.
Mr. Gordon?
I never felt better in my life, thank you.
Try mine.
I don't know you that well.
You talk too much.
About coughing.
Now, never, ever test your bulletproof vest that way. It just can't go well.
Only you.
Another special mention is the Vulcan neck pinch. Somehow, they just wave their hands and say, pressure points. And this doesn't happen very often. But, pressure point.
Back to pressure points. No.
And last special mention, Jim's horse. Jim's horse is always nearby, always comes immediately when he whistles, and is the finest horse anybody could ever have. The last of the gadgets is, of course, the train itself. It's their transport, their resource area, and their base of operations.
Pretty little girl, isn't she? Pity she's such a.
There are guns everywhere. As it's just, there's one here, one there, wherever you need a gun, it's there.
Just as I thought. Look,
there's Wall seems to have multiple uses. It has maps that are awfully handy.
Rome Plateau and Tonka Flats.
This could be the source of something we're looking for.
Right.
And a blackboard for figuring stuff out.
General? But straight from the general.
Why, George?
You shut it. General Grimm has.
It also has special remote control guns.
All right, spill out who you are, mister. Yeah, of course, that's easy enough to explain.
It's
Start explaining, mister.
Oh, I'd be glad to. Now, if you just turn your head a little to the right. Now, in the same way that I was able to point those guns at you.
It's in a secret compartment.
No. No, you don't. You get it, Cyrus.
In this episode, the pistols are part of the trap to catch somebody who tries to open a compartment the wrong way.
Turn that knob just so. You're going to be dead before you hit the floor.
Really? You're frightening me, gentlemen.
And the telegraph. They always seem to be able to reach and be reached by remote people for information or orders. Most of the time, the telegraph is used when the train is stopped, but at least once, the telegraph works while the train is in motion.
Not until we get word from the data bureau on where this card stock came from.
Usually, telegraph is hidden in that box of books there.
Well, did you hear that? There's only one place in town.
The other way is by carrier pigeon. They have at least three carrier pigeons, Henrietta, Arabella, and Annabella, who are kept in various places around a train in different episodes.
Here we are, Annabella. There's a good girl. Ah, yes.
What do you got there for me, Henrietta? Hello, Annabella. I've been waiting for you, little girl. Hello there, Arabella. Welcome home, sweet baby. Yeah, we know it's somewhere in the city, but where exactly? Hello, Arabella. How was the trip, dear girl, huh? Henrietta, meet Lil. Now then. Good girl, Henrietta.
They can also send messages with carrier pigeons hidden in compartments of various devices.
All right, Henrietta. Time for you to go to work, sweetheart. Here we are.
How a carrier pigeon could figure out how to get to a train that moves around is a little obscure. Just go with it, okay?
Now, whatever you do, sweetheart, don't stop to talk to any hogs.
The train has various defenses. It has remote locks. It has various ways to warn people outside the train that something is wrong.
How do you know?
The light at the end of the car, it isn't lit, and it should be. It's a signal.
It has some kind of secret exit.
How about Artie, Seth?
All set, Jim.
And it has ways to attack people who break in. The train also has a variety of support devices. Here's a printing press.
We got a problem.
Another errand for the president.
Frank Slade.
Frank Slade?
The most wanted and least loved.
It's you.
No, not Samuel Toombs. Thaddeus Toombs. Thaddeus.
A team of researchmen can be called into the train to help search for items or people that need to be found.
M.S. from Simmons Institute continued his graduate studies at the University of Munich.
Simmons Institute.
What about that Munich file? Just give me a rundown on it.
Toombs, Thaddeus, graduate student, apprentice instructor, laboratory assistant, and chemistry to Professor Kralla.
Kralla, here it is.
Wolfgang Kralla, Munich University.
Wolfgang Kralla. So Toombs studied under the notorious Professor Kralla.
Who is he, Frank?
He was well on his way to being one of the greatest chemists of all time. Man is a genius.
They can also do audio analysis with devices that are in the train.
He's hanging around the spoon and tree.
And as of 3 p.m. March 29th.
And my favorite of these, a dictaphone.
Well, so much for that.
Tennyson! We're coming in the Manaphy!
And only in the first season, alas, is a manservant, Tennyson.
It's a bit sparse, sir, isn't it?
You're on the wrong side of the track.
Oh. Not sure I don't prefer the other side, sir.
Tennyson assists them from the train in their missions, and once was actually in the field.
It's much too dangerous. So why don't you take Tennyson with you?
Whatever you two brave gentlemen of the Secret Service are discussing, I don't want to know about it.
Not even a combat pay?
No, sir. No, sir. For that, I would need hazardous duty pay in addition to the combat pay.
Watching this. Pretend I'm asking you directions. Turn around and point.
So here's Tennyson.
You almost hit me with that thing.
Why? You're supposed to be unconscious.
A drink?
No, thank thee.
Fire water, sir.
Fire water and soda.
So I hope you like this. Check out my other videos on Wild Wild West and other things, and I'll see you again soon.
Back to Washington, huh, Ned?
Nope, I'm off on a well-deserved vacation.
London, Paris, or Rome?
I'm going to make a big dream come true. And you know what my big dream is? I'm going to spend a vacation all alone on a desert island. Jim, see you.
Good luck.